Why, are you serious?
I like this place.
Actually, I'm not sure I said me. I said, are you sure you want me?
So it's a pleasure for me to introduce Professor Paul de Brack. Professor Paul de Brack is a senior lecturer at the University of Texas at Austin from the computer science department. But Ising is the director of a transversal program throughout the university called the Gamma Project. The Gamma Program. This Gamma Program is the program of the games and mobile media applications. So it's a hard time for us to have him here lecturing summer school on digital game development. And I have to say that when I invited Professor Paul, he said immediately yes. So, thank you very much for accepting our challenge.
Well, I'm not sure I said I said, are you sure you want me to do it? I'm not sure I have anything to say. He said, no, I'm not saying. You were very kind to offer me the opportunity.
Today, we're going to have a talk about seriousness and video games. So what is serious in games?
So let me just say, I'm a little bit nervous. The first time I've given a presentation in Europe. And also because I asked my class today whether I should wear a tie or not, and they said no, because the content of your presentation is going to be much greater than the need to have a tie. And I thought, I hope that's true. We shall see. But before we get there, I want to give you a little bit of background about myself so that you can understand where I'm coming from. I have my bachelor's degree in chemical engineering, which is back way back in ancient history when chemicals was the important thing. But I will see later on I transitioned out of that rapidly. I got a master's of business administration, and I also have a PhD in learning technologies focused on games. And I'm born and raised in Texas. And this is actually how I dress. So I looked into the future and thought there might be something to this thing about computers. There might be a future in computers. From there, I decided to become a consultant. After having an MBA degree, I went around and did consulting on business and technical issues that companies were facing. I even did some business consulting here in Europe. So it was okay as a consultant. A lot of running around and saying. And then from there, I decided that I had done enough things. I was old enough. I started a family. And I wanted to kind of start giving back to the community to grow, help other people succeed. And so I became the executive director of Austin Technology Council, which is a trade association. And I grew that association to be the largest independent high technology trade association in Texas. First off, video games is serious business. More than 150 million, that's more than half the population, play video games, in fact. The very few people who don't play video games, I think this number is actually larger, because I've asked people who are like in their 70s and they have an iPhone, do you play a video game? No, I never play a video game. And I go, hey, I see that there's Candy Crush on your phone. Oh yeah, I play that all the time. So they're not connecting that that the thing that they're playing with is a video game. And so this number may actually even be larger. As the medium grows, the diversity of the population grows, and the impact it has on our society grows. And my kids hardly watch any TV. And it's just not, it's passive and it's kind of boring. They play video games instead. Games are very serious. And if they're so serious that even the University of Texas at Austin has decided to have a game program. They always seem to wait about 10 years too late to start something. They're very conservative over there. And even they couldn't help but notice that there's this thing called games. You know, many years, academics were thinking that, you know, games is something, video games are going to come and go, or it's a small part of the population, but eventually they had to give in to the fact that really it is the 21st century form of expression, creative expression. So they started a program, I started it, and it was, it's called the Game and Mobile Media Applications, GAMMA programming, and it's interdisciplinary in the sense that we had people in different groups. One of the challenges we have, we're a very big university, so we have more than 50,000 students, maybe a couple hundred majors, lots of departments. Anybody that has worked in universities know that one department doesn't like to talk to the other department. They just like to be doing their own thing. So I had to get these departments to talk to each other. So in the College of Fine Arts, we have music, theater, and art. And then the computer science department, where programming are, and then radio, television, film, at least the film department, working together. I'm sort of coordinating the activities of these different departments to make sure that they have the appropriate courses. So, one question, why theater would be part of video games, and then somebody mentioned to me, I didn't know this, it turns out that theater, they've been doing artificial environments to entertain people for like a couple thousand years or so. Who knew? Turns out that if you want to become a good interactive designer and developer, making games is the perfect way to learn. Because games are the most interactive medium out there. And then whatever else you need to do to create an interactive experience, you already know. And you need everybody mixed together because it's a very creative medium and people need to all kinds of different perspectives make for better games, and everybody has a different talent that they bring to the game. In fact, we didn't have artists, what we have, we have a lot of programmers, and they do programmer art, and if you ever see programmer art, you know how that can be a problem. We want to motivate students to take digital media creation courses, whether it's art or programming or sound or whatever. Because one, we want to help industry grow. And I guess maybe I'm fortunate to be in Texas, because there's a lot of companies asking for talent. They call me up and say, hey, do you have a program? If they can work for me. And I say, well, it's too late. But in the end, I really want to educate people to be ready for the 21st century. The best guess I have is that, I think there's going to be a bifurcation of what can happen. Either we continue on this trend of high technology and everything becomes computerized, or we're going to bump into this wall and go down maybe back to the 18th century. That's if global warming or something prevents us from attaining this other pathway. The reputation that educational entertainment, or educational video games is chocolate-covered broccoli. Now, I actually like broccoli. But some people don't like broccoli. And I guess you could put chocolate on the broccoli, and maybe they like broccoli better. Any video games, like Nancy Drew, you learn a lot of stuff in the video game, but you don't, it's not an educational video game. You just happen to learn things in the video game. You might learn things about your culture, you might learn things about a particular time period, and you learn something in the meantime. Some games, the content in the game that you're learning is more valuable than the content is for other games. So I want to motivate and learn people, not by this idea of flashy games and sound, which is like hand flashers, but much more in interacting with the game environment naturally, and the way we normally are motivated to do things, and tap into things that are interesting cognitively, as well as trying to understand, to test our understanding, which you're always doing video games too. You test whether your idea of playing the game is going to work, and test these ideas and construct your knowledge through that. So one idea is to look into commonly called problem-based learning environments, PBL. And these have been around for a long time. They've been mainly used in the medical field. So the problem is they have a patient, and the medical students work together to figure out what the problem is with the patient and solve that problem. It's now being used quite a bit in learning field and as a pedagogical approach to learning. And because students are like naturally motivated to learn about solving a problem, right? I mean, if you're a medical student, you should be naturally motivated to learn how to solve a problem of a patient. It's not like something like, hey, read about solving problems about patients. Here is a patient. This patient is dying. Please solve the problem of this, right? They're naturally want to learn that and motivated to do so. And so putting the student in the middle of this problem, and it's an authentic problem, is I think a way that they can provide them with not only learning, but deep learning about the problems and how to solve them. And this is more than just what we exams. I don't know if you have experience that maybe I had. You stuff a whole bunch of information and you walk into the exam and you take the exam, and then you walk out of the exam room and for some magical way, all that information is gone out of your head. Right? That's not deep learning, right? That's very shallow learning. Deep learning is something that is you can really hold on to the rest of your life. And when you have solving a problem, then you obtain that kind of deep learning. My question was, what I was trying to see, can I make students interested in science by playing this game? So can I get from the game, like they like the game, they learn science, okay, that's good, I appreciate that. Now, can they then like science? Because the majority of students typically are not excited by science. And remember, put yourself back when you were 13 years old, how often did you talk about classwork outside of the class? Probably, maybe never, unless it was like, you know, something that you complained about. It's not about complaining, it's actually talking about the game. Games are kind of just the opposite. They are very concerned about the outcome. They usually don't care about how you solve the problem, how you go through the world. They care about the outcome, like winning the game. So in conclusion, students found space science more interesting than expected. I don't think anybody said, hey, I want to become a space science person now, but you know, they did find some interest in that. I didn't change their attitude. I think because they knew that right after this game experience, they're gonna go back to the regular classroom experience of the teacher lecturing them. So they end up with the boring book. So they knew that to them the science is still was going to be boring. So one-time intervention did not work. Now, I would literally look forward to having a whole year where you did things like play games to learn science. I bet you we'd have a lot more people interested in learning science then. Also, it turns out that children, even when they're 13 years old, 12, 13 years old, have high expectations on the games. You know, they have one student continuously try to break the game And he found this little jump thing, and he did it over and over again, like a couple hundred times, until the game crashed. I'm like, that's great. I have to make sure that it's the things that we teach the students are things that are guided by society, right? Again, hiding from hand grenades is probably not something that we need, virtually is not something that's valid. It does turn out, by the way, that aggressive, violent people do like to play video games. Well, violent video games. But causation is in a different direction. They're already aggressive, violent people, and they are attracted to violence in the video games. And it's also been shown, by the way, that surgeons who play video games are better surgeons than surgeons that don't play video games. But maybe next time you need a surgery, you should ask the doctor, Now, you might be concerned if he says he plays violent video games. I don't know what that means in surgery. So right now I'm working on a heart failure management game. And this is trying to help heart failure patients. Now, in my world, I'm learning stuff. This is for the School of Nursing. I think of heart failure as binary. Your heart's working. Your heart's not working. In the second case, you're gone. There is no in between. It turns out I was wrong. There are states in between that where your heart is sort of functioning and can function to keep you alive, but you have to maintain yourself for it to occur, for it to do its job. So things like eating a lot of salt is not maintaining yourself. And so the idea is to have a heart failure management game where it teaches the player how to manage their heart failure condition so that the quality of their lives improve and they don't go to the hospital constantly.
Why are you serious?
I like this place. I mean, it's surprising me. There's a lot of places in Europe. I've visited a lot of places. And I like those places to visit, but I would never want to live there. Like Paris? I would never want to live there. Oh, so is it Paris here? I would never want to live in Paris. Right? Fantastic city to visit. I could spend a week looking at stuff in Paris. Fantastic. But I would never want to live there. I could see living in Porto. The weather's great here. Better than Austin was. It's about the same size as where Austin, Texas, where I'm from. They both have great universities. Porto's more beautiful than Austin is, sad to say. Rui and I are having an argument about which one's more expensive food-wise, Austin or Porto. I tell you, if you're going to order wine, Porto is cheaper, for sure. Porto's got better public transportation than Austin. Both of them have good airports that are close to areas that are other cities that have that are big. There's only some small differences. So, like for instance, a starting programmer here gets paid, all the way down to 600 euros per month, all the way up to 1,600 euros a starting programmer. In Austin, I don't know, it's like 5,000 or 6,000 euros a month. So I'm like, okay. Look, it's the market. Well, look at some of the traditional trading partners that Portugal has, right? Long-term relationships with more countries than this, right? I'm just naming four of them that are so obvious that you couldn't argue against me, right? Spain, England, France, Brazil, you combine the markets of these, that's huge, right? How long does it take to get an airplane from here to Paris?
Two hours?
London?
2 hours.
Okay, so these markets are readily accessible, right? So, how much does it cost a program to say, let's go all the way up to Amsterdam, which maybe takes 3 hours to get to or something. How much does a programmer make there? Like
€6,000 or €7,000 a month. Something's missing here. How can that difference be? You can't convince me that it's because they're smarter than you are, or they work harder than you are. Or more educated than you are. I'm not convinced by that at all. Right? If you had this much market difference between programmers in the United States, they would be flocking here in growth. They'd be like, wow, this is fantastic. So maybe one idea is to start a company here, and start outsourcing programming services or creative services to these other countries.
Actually, I don't mind if you go to Paris. Go to Paris, learn some stuff, get some connections, come back to Porto, and then outsource your skills back to Paris. That's also works, right? But I want this to be an area where it's a high-tech center as well.
Which leads me to the idea that maybe there needs to be much more of a culture of entrepreneurship here. By the way, I know that I'm never going to be asked to keynote again, so I'm going to give one last full keynote here and be controversial. And I think the university should help create this culture of entrepreneurship. At the University of Texas, when I got my MBA, there was, which was, by the way, a long time ago, there was beginning and starting of entrepreneurship courses in the business school. And now it's all over the university. Engineering, computer science, all programs have something to do with entrepreneurship in courses. And there's a dozen different efforts on doing entrepreneurship at UT. There's an incubator, there's a lot of incubators. There's a lot of incubators outside of UT. And we celebrate successes, no matter how little. Like this guy, her, she's not high tech, but wow, she's made a lot of money in her life, right? And we celebrate them, of course we celebrate the big successes, but you can celebrate the small successes and grow from there. We should celebrate any success. Anyway, we should call up those four companies that are here, three or four, game companies, and say, yes, that's awesome that you're doing that, right? How can we help? And the other thing that I think needs to, and this is a harder one, is start accepting that failure can occur and that it's a good thing, right? Now, let's think about this. Here's how to teach, the proper way of teaching. When they're a baby, right, and they stand up, and then they start walking and they fall down, you should go up to them and start yelling at them that they failed and that they should not fail ever. And that's a very great way for them to learn how to crawl for the rest of their lives. Right? We should accept that failure occurs. This is how we grow as humans, is through failure. And that the fear of failure dooms us to a life of stagnation. So, and of course, if I knew the football players better, I'd probably have the same exact quote from a football player, but I had one from a basketball player, Bill O'Meara. And this Michael Jordan is probably one of the greatest, if not the greatest, basketball player ever. And he failed miserably. The other thing is, we got to learn how to love geeks and nerds, right? And let me just say, being a geek is sexy. Programmer that's been a programmer for 10 years or 20 years, great. That means you're a great programmer. And if in fact, many times in the U.S., the programmers make more money than their boss. Okay? Because if you're a really good programmer, you're making a lot of money for the company. They're going to compensate you. So my call to action is that, you know, we start teaching entrepreneurship. We mentor entrepreneurs in the classroom. You know, we have courses on entrepreneurship. We have, obviously, an incubator that helps mature companies out there. We look for funding sources. By the way, has anybody pitched, I'm going to say this, Gulbenkian, did I say that right?
Yeah.
Foundation for a Portuguese game? Has anybody pitched that to them yet? I've heard they might have some money. And that they're interested in things that are Portuguese. Maybe a Portuguese game. So look for funding sources out there and venture capital and start growing companies here that way. Love the nerds. Have a nerd day here. Have game jams here where nerds get together and make games. Promote the fact that the nerds are good. And take a long view of this because it's not going to happen overnight. And as the Chinese proverb goes, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now. And I'm reminded by somebody, I don't know if anybody's seen this guy before. But this guy is, I'm going to say it the American way, okay? So you guys just hang in there. Marquis of Pomba, Marquis of Pomba, and our coming Marques or something like that in Portuguese. When I came in here, I said Dom Henrique, and the guy's like, "What? There's no hotel Dom Henrique here." And I think Dom Henrique. In 1756, by the way, I'm going to teach you a little bit about history here. In 1756, he was the prime minister here, and he implemented draconian measures to save the Douro Valley wine production. And although unpopular at the time, it resulted in improvement of the quality of port wine and ushered in a new era of growth and prosperity for the producers and shippers. In establishing the geographical limits of port vineyards, classifying them to quality, according to quality, and establishing standards for the production of wine. Pombal was a visionary who created the first modern controlled designation of origin, which was a precursor of the current Origin Contrôlée. AOC, right? Porto, think about this. Porto is still profiting from this more than 250 years later. So let's start by establishing the new high-tech businesses here to usher in the new era for Porto and hope that that lasts for another 250 years. Thanks.
And thank you all for being engaged in games, loving games, and being able to read the letter. So thank you, and please, thank you very much.